Never roll in the hay. Welcome back in, ladies and gentlemen. Game two here from Macomb Community College at the Macomb Baseball Field. It's your Monarchs taking on Schoolcraft. Game one was a thriller. 3-2 victory for Macomb on a walk-off hit by pitch to Derek Ruiz. My name is Tom Cavanaugh, taking you through the doubleheader all day long between the Monarchs and the Ocelots. We'll run down the pitching matchups as well as the defensive lineup here. A couple of changes in the field and on the mound for Macomb today. On the mound, it's going to be Derek Neufeld. Derek Neufeld, he's a freshman coming out of Leamington, Ohio. He's making his fourth appearance this year. Last time out was April 6th against Jackson College. He gave up 6 hits, 5 runs, in 4 1/3 innings, but he did strike out 7 in that time. He's got 7 strikeouts in his last 2 outings, so he misses a whole heck of a lot of bats when he's on the mound. Defensively, it's Luke Babcock doing the catching here in game two. Ryan McKay stays at third. Ruiz at shortstop. Alex Mendez at second base. Brady Krazuk at first. And then in the outfield, all the same with Dane Richards in left, Riley Ames in center, and Ty Stepik in right. For Schoolcraft, they're going to roll out their lineup a little bit differently today. Sawyer Pace on the mound, batting first, playing second. Ben Cannon in right field, batting second. Dom Westfall batting third. He's going to do the catching in game two for the Ocelots. Batting fourth, Brian Tuttle at first base. Owen Elsie, the left fielder, bats fifth. Drew Thorning playing third base. He'll bat sixth. Batting fifth, Isander Vega in center field. And eighth, Dalton Vance at shortstop. Abel Gutierrez finishes out the lineup as the DH facing Derek Neufeld. We're all set to go here from game two. After a one-run victory, walk-off fashion for the Monarchs. Quick stat between these two teams. 4 total meetings between the clubs. 3 out of the 5 final scores have been decided by 1 run. There's a strike called on the outside corner to Sawyer Pace. Umpires have flipped. It's now Blake Barnes behind the plate and Tim Eigel in the field. Neufeld delivers a fastball right by Pace, 0-2. And that's where those 14 strikeouts in the last 6 2/3 innings come from in his last 2 outings combined for Neufeld. Just that upper fastball, tough to catch up to from either side of the dish. Babcock sitting up outside, here's the 0-2. Check swing, did he go? They're gonna check, he did not. Tim Eigel in the field, says safe, he didn't go. 1-2 now. Wanna give a huge tip of the cap once again to Hector Jaimez and how he played in game one on the mound, keeping this Ocelot offense to just 2 runs. And then Jack Saputo, he induced an incredible double play that came right back to him to end the frame. Saputo picks up a big win, much needed for his club and for himself and his record. 2 balls and 2 strikes to Pace. Swing and a miss. Fastball, outer half. Just misses the bat of Sawyer there, 1 gone. That ball had a little bit of run on it too, coming out of the right hand of Neufeld. Started middle out and just kind of swung to the right-handed side of the box there. Unhittable, really. As soon as Pace went to pull the trigger, he knew that ball was just a little bit too far out. And there's a hanger, a banger that lands in for a strike. Definitely not a hanger with the amount of late movement there was on that one. 0-1 to Ben Cannon. Setting up outside again is Babcock. Here comes the fastball. Right by him, 0-2. We saw Hector Jaimez kind of start the same way, filling up the zone and hitting spots. Same thing with Carlos Plasencia of Schoolcraft. He pitched a great game, did not come out with the loss. Here's a ball in the dirt. Calvin Gonzalez, he gained the loss. It was a crazy finish to our game. It was 2 outs with nobody on. Dane Richards hit a double to keep the game alive, and then you had walk, hit by pitch to end it. Strike 3 on the outside corner. Cannon goes down looking. And Neufeld with back-to-back Ks to start things here to open the ball game.
The catcher, Dom Westfeld.
Dom Westfall, the catcher here in game two. It was Barrett Barker in game one. Dom will swing it in the 3 spot today as he takes a breaking ball low. Monarchs will face the crafty lefty, Riley Nigmeyer, on the mound for Scraft. There's a fastball, swung on and missed. 1-1. Rosenfeld. Fastball just a bit inside. He liked the spot, just couldn't catch it for home plate umpire Blake Barnes. Westfall and then Tuttle after him if we get to that point. Here's the 2-1. Breaking ball, skied in the air. Out of play, foul back towards the parking lot over our right side here. That wind has mildly settled down. I mean, American flag out there in right field still moving, billowing a little bit in from right field, directly in from right field. Here's the 2-2. Just low. Neufeld walking off the mound thinking that was strike three. So did we. And so did Riley Ames in center. He took a few steps towards his dugout on the third base side. Three balls, two strikes, two outs. We're in the top of the first inning. No score in game two between Macomb and Schoolcraft. He spiked the fastball. Two-out walk to Dom Westfall. It was well done from Derek Neufeld. He really got him with that breaking ball at the knees, just a little bit low. And that's something that you kind of have to adapt with throughout the ball game. You're going to have two different umpires with two completely different strike zones.
Number 12, Brady Sauer running at first.
So Heigl was behind the plate in game one. Barnes now does the job.
And
that's not saying anything derogatory or bad about any of these umpires. They just have different zones, and they call the game differently. So you as a hitter and as a catcher, pitcher, whatever, you got to be able to adapt and make adjustments depending on how that goes. See which pitches are going to be called for strikes, which ones are not. And if you're a pitcher, you really have to pay attention to that. Brian Tuttle starts out 1-0. 2-0 now. Good block up from Babcock. That breaking ball, much too short in front of the plate. Couple of strikeouts to start the ball game for Derek Neufeld. He just walked Dom Westfall. He's got Tuttle at the dish. Big swing and a miss there on the 2-0. We weren't getting enough breeze. We got some there from the bat of Tuttle. He took a huge hack at that one. Maybe the wind will switch out towards left center a little bit. Neufeld delivers. That's a spiked fastball. Another block up from Babcock, 3-1. Neufeld coming in at 6-1, 215, as we said, out of Leamington, Ohio, went to Cardinal Carter Catholic Secondary High School. Neufeld checks the runner, Westfall. 3-1 pitch is down the heart of the plate for a strike. Opening frame in this game two on a beautiful Sunday. Could not ask for a better day for baseball. Here's the full count. Strike three! Outside corner. Gets Tuttle looking. Derek Neufeld strikes out the side to open the ball game. Monarchs come to bat in the bottom half. This is your home for Macomb baseball. You got Monarchs and Ocelots here from game two in Warren. Thank you.
Leading off for Macomb.
Bottom half of the first inning. It's top of the lineup, and Alex Mendez, they're going to face the crafty lefty, Riley Nigmeyer, on the mound. Fifth start of the year for Riley. He's 1-0. 17 strikeouts in 21 and a third innings pitched, rocking a 1.69 ERA. Last time he was out was against the Bears earlier last week. It's a fastball outside to Mendez for a ball. Five strikeouts, three walks in six innings for Riley. And there's a breaking ball, much too far out of the zone. 2-0. Mendez had a very clutch RBI base hit in the sixth inning to keep the game where it was, or to tie the ball game again. Mendez now hard ground ball onto third. One up, one down. Nice play from Thorning.
Now batting the first baseman, Brady Krazuk.
Now Krazuk's turn with one out. Nigmeyer gave up five hits, two runs in those six innings against the Bears. He was pretty solid. He gained velocity as the game went on, was throwing low 80s to start, and then he started to get into the upper 80s with some of his other crafty stuff, mixing in the off-speed. First pitch to Krazuk is high and in. Working third base side of the rubber. He kicks and fires. Another fastball outside. More velocity here in game two. We're seeing from Riley. Placencia was awesome on the mound for Schoolcraft. Had a lot of good off-speed pitches as well. But these Macomb hitters, they catch up to anything. Another fastball outside, 3-0. Krazuk back in game one. He was 1-for-4. Had a base hit in his first at-bat. It was quiet since. Wags that bat softly over the left shoulder, waiting on a 3-0. Make it four straight. One out walk for Krazuk. Helping keep that on-base percentage, that OPS, all the way up there. I mean, you're hitting
the right fielder,
450 plus, you're looking at a pretty good number in that OPS category there. And Brady draws a lot of walks as well. Ty Stepik steps in. He takes a strike on the outside corner. Nice breaking ball from Riley there. Gets it from the outside corner, the left-handed box, and sits it right on the corner with how much cut that had. Ground ball, base hit in the left field for Ty Stepik. Holding up at two will be Krazuk. That's a hard hit ball in between short and third. Well done from Ty. So two aboard with one out now. Stepik was all over that pitch for Riley Nigmeyer. It's now time for Dylan Pawlenski. Dylan getting his very first at-bat of the afternoon. Did not play in game one. Rinna was the DH earlier today, and now Pawlenski, who's hitting .328 on the year, he digs into that right-handed box. 21 total hits. He's got five doubles and two home runs with 14 RBIs to his name. Long look down at second base as Nigmeyer steps off and checks the runner back. A lot of pop in that right-handed bat for Dylan. Redshirt sophomore from Shelby Township, and this ball's going to kick away from the catcher Westfall. Down to third is Krazuk, and on to second will be Ty Stepik. So a pass ball, it's going to be on Westfall behind the dish. It's the first one we've really seen get away from a Schoolcraft catcher today. It was pretty clean in the first game besides that last pitch that Calvin Gonzalez threw that hit Derek Ruiz. That was the end of the ball game. Walk-off hit by pitch for the Monarchs. Breaking ball way out of the zone. Westfall's got to jump out and make the catch. So Pawlenski with a good situation here to drive in a run. You got the infielders back in Vance and Pace. Corner infielders are in front of the bag by just a few feet. Ground ball up the middle should do it. Fastball inside, in and out of the glove once again of Westfall. Three balls and no strikes. Nick Myers 3-0 pitch, tap foul towards the third base dugout. Riley with multiple walks in his last few outings. He has one so far today. Pawlenski, swing and a miss. And that backswing hits Westfall in the back of the head, Alex Avila style. 3-2 now. It's always a little ring in the skull when you get the backswing to the back of the catcher's mask. Full count, one out. Line drive over the head of Vance at shortstop into left center field. Krazuk's in, coming around is Stepik. He's going to score. Throw gets away, down to second with the tag, and he's out. Pawlenski tries to pick up an extra bag on the missed throw from left field, but he cashes in two RBIs, and it's 2-0 Monarchs here in the first. Nice swing from Dylan. He was a little out ahead of that pitch and kept his barrel through the zone and lifted it into left center. First pitch to Babcock. He has to tiptoe out of the way as it comes in close. 2-0 Monarchs thanks to Dylan Pawlenski. He's cut down trying to take second base. The throw didn't really get that far away from the infielders here for the Ocelots, but enough for Dylan to try at it. It was a bang-bang play. Great throw from the third baseman, Drew Thorning. Babcock checks his swing. That's high and inside. 2-1. Some early trouble for Riley Nigmeyer and this Schoolcraft Ocelots program here. They absolutely need game two. There's a swing and a miss from Luke. Two's across the board now. Definitely going to be playing with a little higher intensity. They came out firing in game one. Didn't score a lot of runs, but they played solid defense. Pitching was great. They fell late. Macomb was able to steal it, scoring one in the sixth and one in the seventh. The 3-2, swing and a miss. Babcock swings at that pitch high and outside, and that ends the frame. Two runs in the inning. Dylan Pawlenski, two runs single to left center field. We go to the second. Monarchs lead it 2-0. This is your home for Macomb baseball.
The batter, Owen Elsie.
Welcome back, top of the second inning. 2-0 lead for Macomb here at home in game two. Owen Elsie will lead things off against Derek Neufeld, who really had his way in the first inning and starts it off strong with a strike on the outside corner. Good fastball. Struck out the side, one swinging, two looking, had a walk in that first. Everything else has been solid. That's off the plate, 1-1. Dominant fastball from Neufeld. He can mix in the off speed. Saw that breaking ball snap in on the corner outside. Drops that one a little bit low, blocked up from Babcock. Dylan Pawlenski with the two-run single. Another off-speed pitch, not close. 3-1 now. Cloud coverage starting to roll in a little bit, not really affecting our day much. Still sunny and breezy. That's ball four. Ball looked to be on the black on the lower outside corner. Home plate umpire Blake Barnes says no. So it's a leadoff walk to Owen Elsie. He's had a pretty good day, a couple hits in game one. Now Drew Thorning steps up. Thorning with a heads up play to cut down Pawlenski, trying to stretch his single to a double. Big swing and a miss. Two-seamer cutting in on the hands. Huge hack there from Thorning. He's down 0-1. As we said, three out of the five contests so far this year have been decided by one run between these two teams, so every base runner is crucial. Here's a fastball that's fouled away. Too late on that one was Thorning. After Thorning, it's Isander Vega, Dalton Vance, and Abel Gutierrez rounding out that Ocelot lineup. Good lead at first for Owen Elsie. Here's the 0-2. High pop up, back towards the parking lot again. I appreciate everybody tuning in for both games today. It was an awesome game one, fantastic finish. And this second game, gonna be a lot like the first. Likely going to be very neck-and-neck close game between these two programs, very evenly matched. But Macomb taking that first game was huge. They now move into sole possession of second place in the MCCAA East at 7-4. Henry Ford was ahead of them at 6-3, and here's a line drive to left center field. Riley Ames comes over, and it's going to fall for a single. Base hit for Drew Thorning, and now Schoolcraft with two on with nobody out. But Henry Ford College, they were in second at 6-3 in conference. Macomb was in third at 6-4. They now bump up with seven wins into second place behind Jackson. Jackson is 8-3. Nice swing right there from Drew Thorning. Center fielder Isander Vega. He's pinch ran the last several games. Going to get a chance here with two on, nobody out. Breaking ball. He tried to bunt, had to pull it back. Wise choice, that missed low. Krizuk playing in front of the runner at first at the grass cutout. McKay in front of the bag as well at third. Another bunt attempt, pulling it back. It's in the dirt. Good block up from Babcock once again. Making sure everything stays in and around that plate in the two boxes. Going to get time for a moment. Conversation out on the mound with Derek Neufeld, who started out very nicely on the mound. Three strikeouts, walked one, but here in this inning, control issues, just a little bit on a few batters. He had Owen Elsie grabbing a walk on five pitches. And now Vega, he's ahead in the count 2-0. I feel like a few of those curveballs, those slider off-speed pitches there, just landing a little bit short. If he finishes those pitches and gets it to the dish, could be a different story for a lot of these at-bats here. That was just the first base hit, though, of the day in game two for Schoolcraft. Here's the 2-0. Bunt. Foul. Vega tried to get it down the third baseline. So that's going to help out Derek just a little bit more. 2-1 here as Ocelot's trying to play a little bit of small ball, get their runners up into scoring position. 2-0. Macomb's on top. We're in the top of the second inning. Two runners on for Schoolcraft at the moment. Two-one is outside for a ball. Snapping the glove over was Babcock. Potentially crossed up on that pitch. It looked like Babcock was set up completely different, awaiting some off-speed. Here's the 3-1 pitch. In the dirt. And the Schoolcraft Ocelots have the bases loaded with nobody out here in the second inning. Dalton Vance, he gets his very first at-bat of the afternoon. Also did not play in game one. Vance just 5 hits on the year. He's got 5 RBIs as well. Looking for a few more, and he's going to get them. Line drive in the right center field gap. Elsie's going to score. Thorning holds up at third base. So now it's 2-1. RBI single for Vance. Base is still loaded with nobody out. Both teams bringing the swings early on, contrary to what we saw in game one.
The designated hitter, Abel Gutierrez.
Final batter in this Schoolcraft lineup, Abel Gutierrez. Designated hitter in this game two. Infield is all the way in right now for Macomb. Here's a breaking ball for a strike on the outside corner. This pitch from Derek. A few more of those. He could work himself out of a tough jam right here. Breaking ball in the dirt. Did he check his swing and go around? They said he did not. He checked his swing, 1-1. Anything on the ground, on the infield, they're going home to Babcock. Here's the 1-1 pitch. Line fouled on the right field line. Gutierrez, 5 hits and 5 RBIs as well. Same as Vance, who now has 6 hits with 6 RBIs. That breaking ball in the dirt. Nice stop from Babcock. A lot of times with breaking balls like that with so much spin, catchers will have trouble with those. Babcock keeps it right in front. 2 balls, 2 strikes, nobody out. It's a 2-1 ball game. Schoolcraft's already scored 1 in the inning. Ground ball up the middle. It's back to the mound. Neufeld throws it home. They're going to hold it at first. Krizuk was ready for it, and Babcock just didn't throw down. Nice play from Derek Neufeld on the mound. It's a ground ball up the middle. He made a nice play on it. Thought there was a chance it could get into center field. But he had the fast glove.
Sawyer, pace.
So getting to first will be Gutierrez. Thorning, he's cut down trying to score. So they get the force at home. Breaking ball, ground ball into right field, a base hit. Coming in to score is going to be Vega. They're going to throw to the plate. Vance, he's out at the dish. What a throw from Ty Stepik out in right field for out number 2. We stay tied at 2 apiece. It could have been 3-2 Schoolcraft, but Stepik, who's holding his right arm out there in right field, he threw him out, so great assist from the Macomb right fielder. But you see Taylor Jelikowski, head coach of Macomb, looking out there at his starting right fielder and kind of hanging over that right arm, grabbing the shoulder rotator cuff area.
The right fielder, Ben Cannon.
So RBI base hit for Sawyer Pace. He's aboard. Vance was out at the plate, but coming in to score was Isander Vega. 2-2 tie now. This ball's in the dirt. Nice job from Babcock as he dives to make that pick. Just saved a run right there, did Luke. Already some movement in the bullpen right now from Macomb. It's already 2-2 in the second inning. That was what we were going into the seventh with. Swing and a miss from Cannon. Pace was able to make it down a second on a, he was stealing anyways. That ball was low and inside. It would have allowed the runner from third to score. High pop up on the 1-1. It's gonna be a long run for Richards. Coming over, battling the sun. He makes the catch in foul territory down the left field line. Two runs in the inning. Dalton Vance and Sawyer Pace get it done to tie the ball game up. We go to the bottom of the second inning. Schoolcraft and Macomb tied up. This is your home, Macomb Baseball.
Now batting the left fielder, Dane Richards.
Second crack at it here for Macomb. Here in game two. We're tied up at two apiece. Swing and a miss from Dane Richards facing Riley Nigmeyer. Ty Stepik held the game at 2-2 after he threw out a runner at home plate. Dalton Vance it was. 1-1. Richards, a pretty good game. He kept game one alive with that double. Swings and misses there to make it 1-2. RBI single in the third inning and then a double and came in to score the winning run in the seventh. He's playing left field in both games today. The 1-2 from Riley, high and outside, 2-2. Richards, McKay, and Ruiz here in the second inning to face Nigmeyer. Breaking ball lined into left field for a single. Dane Richards continues to put good swings on the baseball, and he's going opposite sides of the field. His double in game one was down the right field line, and now he ropes one into left. Good leadoff swing brings up Ryan McKay. Opening pitch to McKay, high and inside for a ball. Ryan in game one had multiple plays at third base. Highlight plays. He was also 2-for-3 with a walk, single and a double at the plate. There's a breaking ball that catches the outside corner. A lot of movement on that pitch, not just down, but also moving to the left, swinging in, back into the plate from the left-handed box. McKay squares the bunt, pulls back, it's down low. Two balls and one strike. Another bunt attempt. This one's popped up. Nigmeyer makes the catch. Falling to the ground was Dom Westfall trying to head out there to make the grab. So a pop-out bunt from McKay to the pitcher's mound has one on with one out.
Now batting the shortstop, number two, Derek Ruiz.
Hero in game one, Derek Ruiz, hit by a pitch with the bases loaded, led to a 3-2 victory. First pitch to Derek's fouled away. Before that walk-off hit by pitch, he was 1-for-2, or 1-for-1, with a walk and a sacrifice bunt. Fastball, first strike, upper outer corner, it's now 0-2. Teams with three hits apiece. The makings of another classic between these two. Strike three on the outside corner. Breaking ball set away from the lefty Ruiz, and he watches that one. He thought it was off the plate. That's three strikeouts. Check that. Two strikeouts now for Riley Nigmeyer.
Center fielder Riley Ames.
So two outs now after the leadoff single to Dane Richards. Last batter in this Monarch lineup, Riley Ames, cuts through the first one, a little bit of a half swing there. Checks the runner over at first, taken off. Here's a line drive, base hit into right field. Richards, he's gonna go first to third. Clutch swing from Riley Ames with two outs, has runners on the corners here in the second.
Now batting.
Alex Mendez's
baseman,
turn. He grounded out to third base his first time. That was last inning. He's got a chance to do something here. Monarchs were incredible in game one with two outs. They scored all of their runs with two outs, all three of them, in three separate innings. First pitch, down and away. Good stop from Westfall. He just barely got there. Mendez a quiet day so far between both games, except for that clutch base hit in the right field that dropped in front of the right fielder Ben Cannon. Mendez takes a strike now at the knees. And I'm going to say here in game two, I think the wind will play a factor in a lot of these sky-high fly balls in the outfield, but these outfielders are going to make some better adjustments. Here's Mendez. He lifts one out to left center field. Not enough on it. Going back and making the catch is Elsie at the wall. Mendez put a charge into that one a few feet short out there in deep left center field. We're tied at two. We head to the third inning between Schoolcraft and Macomb. This is your home, Macomb Community College Athletics. Three, four, five hitters. Two up for Schoolcraft here in the top of the third inning to face Derek Neufeld. Third inning of action is brought to you by First State Bank, a community bank with nationwide ATMs and locations throughout Macomb County, offering consumer and business banking since 1917. First State Bank, call them now. Shaky second inning for Derek Neufeld. He's looking to right the ship here in the third. Struck out the side in the opening frame. It was awesome. Second inning, he walked two, gave up three hits. Two runs were scored, and that's kind of where we sit now at two apiece. Both teams scoring in the opening couple of innings. Dom Westfall checks his swing again. He's down 0-2. Westfall walked back in the first inning. Didn't get anywhere past first base. Neufeld quickly shut it down with a strikeout to Tuttle, who's due up next. 2-2 fastball on the ground to second. Forehand play for Mendez. On to first. How about Alex right there making that play before it hits the grass cutout for the outfield? A lot of times some infielders, they'll play really deep there and let the ball get a little too far, and it hits that lip going into the outfield, separating the dirt from the outfield grass. And he did a nice job of meeting the ball beforehand on a clean play. Tuttle struck out looking his first time. Wags the bat over the right shoulder. Takes a big cut down to a knee, Adrian Beltre style. He's down 0-1. Tuttle on the year, batting 309, 30 total hits, 11 doubles. Just one homer for him. There's a breaking ball on the outside corner. Very late call from home plate umpire Blake Barnes. Neufeld through the windup. Here's the 0-2. Down and away, blocked up by Babcock. Does a great job behind the dish, keeping everything in front. We've seen not too many spiked fastballs, but those offbeat pitches that are landing a couple feet short. Doing a nice job of deadening the ball, keeping it right in front on that plate. Here's the 1-2. Low again. It's not missing by much. If he starts that ball just a little bit higher, it's going to set in for a strike at the knees. Two balls, two strikes, one out. We're tied up at two here in the top of the third inning of game two from Macomb Community College. There's the spike fastball, 3-2 now. Not something we've seen a whole lot from Neufeld on the mound. It's really just the off-speed he struggled to throw for a strike. But you have to work those pitches in. You can't just throw a fastball on a two-seam. Got to go with the changeup, got to go with a cut or slider. Here's the 3-2. Fouled out of play. Going to keep it at full with one out. Two curveball on the corner for strike three. How about Derek Neufeld trusting his off-speed stuff on a full count?
The left fielder, Owen Elsie.
Beautiful pitch freezes Tuttle for the second time today. Two gone here in the third. It's not something that Brian was expecting whatsoever. Thought it might be a fastball, outer half with two strikes. Got to go after a pitch like that, but it just froze you. Strikeout number four today for Derek Neufeld on the mound. Here's the 1-0. Line drive into left field. Going in and now going back is going to be Richards, and he makes the play. Quick inning for Derek Neufeld and the Monarchs. We head to the bottom of the third, still tied up, 2-2 apiece. This is your home for Macomb Community College Baseball.
Hey!
Bottom of the third inning. You're from Macomb Community College. Tom Cavanaugh taking you all the way through today's doubleheader between the Monarchs and the Schoolcraft Ocelots. Riley Nigmeyer back on the mound for his third inning of work. Gave up two in the first. Had a really nice second inning. Dane Richards and Riley Ames had a couple of singles, but he was able to get out of another jam. Schoolcraft has been great at that so far today. Both teams with a lot of runners left on base. Slider misses high and away. It's 1-1 to Brady Krizuk. Brady walked and scored back in the first inning, thanks to the Dylan Pawensky two-run single. Fastball down and outside. Neufeld before the inning was able to strike out Tuttle and then get an easy flyout to Elsie. It was really nice for him to go 1-2-3 after seeing seven batters in the second inning. It's another off-speed pitch down and inside, 3-1. Nigmeyer on the mound has just been struggling a little bit with control. Has one walk in the first inning, a couple of hits last few frames, and here's a ground ball to third. Nice play from Thorning, and he overthrows first base. Wide of the bag, no play for Tuttle. He was not able to make a catch there. It's gonna be an E5 on Thorning, who made a really nice play over there, just an errant throw. Lets the leadoff man Krizuk
right
aboard.
Fielder.
As much as I'd love to continue to bolster that batting average for Brady Krizuk, that is definitely a throwing error over there at third for Thorning. So Krizuk's aboard via the air, and it's now time for Ty Stepik. He's already got an assist, threw out a runner in the second inning all the way from right field. Lines it back right at us. Base hit and a run scored in the first for Ty. Battling injury all year long and doing a great job of it. One of the toughest kids on this team. Shows no signs as he lifts one out, fouled on the left field line. Bullpen, not able to make a catch there. We talked about it in the first game. Both bullpens on the right and left side, both are in play. And when I say in play, it's foul territory, but still playable, not on the opposite side of the fence. No balls, two strikes to Stepik, and he's gonna get hit with a fastball. Right in the calf. First two men are aboard. Error and a hit by pitch. Brings up Dylan Pawensky.
The designated hitter, Dylan Pawensky.
Hey, O'Mac, ladies and gentlemen.
Pawensky, the reason. Macomb is tied up right now. Two-run single over the head of Dalton Vance at shortstop. That was back in the first inning. He's got the same two base runners right now in Krizuk at second and Stepik at first. Breaking ball set in for a strike on the inner half, 0-1. 2-2, bottom three of game two of our doubleheader. Pivotal games in the race for the top two seeds in the MCCAA East Division. Line drive, base hit into right field for Paw. Coming around third, it's gonna be Krizuk. He's held up there. Cannon with a really nice throw from right field. And McCombs got him loaded with nobody out. And that just shows the duality of a hitter like Dylan Pawensky right there. The ability to line a ball into left field when you're out in front of a pitch on a breaking ball, and then your next at bat, you take a fastball on the outer half and shoot it into right field. Very impressive from Dylan Pawensky. Bases loaded, he's 2-for-2 today. Babcock's turn, he takes a ball high. Struck out swinging his first time. Seen Luke with some incredible power this year. He's one hop the wall out in dead center at 440. Actually, he hit it off the wall, middle of the way up in dead center. He's got three doubles, a triple and one home run on the year. 8 RBIs for Luke. There's a strike on the outside corner. Good battle from Nigmeyer on the mound, makes it 2-1. Krizuk's at third, he reached on an error. Stepik at two, he was hit by a pitch. Swing and a tap back to the screen. Pawensky, he just singled at first base. Check, Riley has battled back now to 2-2 with nobody out. The pitch. Out of play. Good fight from Babcock there. Not the easiest pitch to be able to catch up to right there, so good fight. That was a fastball up near the letters. Elevating those hands and getting the barrel to that spot is always tough. Might have to do it again here. The 2-2. Breaking ball way outside. I think Babcock knew that one was coming, just wanted to see if it was going to be in for a strike. We've seen some good movement from Nick Meyer on the mound, curling the ball in back into the zone when it originally starts outside. 3-2 pitch, grounded up the middle. Nick Meyer throws home. They get the runner at home onto first, and it's a two-out rally now. Double play. Nick Meyer throws home. Westfall to first.
The left fielder, Dane Richard.
As we said, two-out rally time. 2-2 ball game with runners at second and third. That's the last thing that you want right there with the bases loaded and nobody out. Dane Richard singled to start the second inning. He's going to try to save this third. Breaking ball at the feet. One, two, three, double play on your score sheet there from Luke Babcock. We're still tied at two. Runners on second and third. Here's a ground ball between short and third and into left field. Dane Richards continues to come up big for the Monarchs. 3-2 lead from Macomb as Ty Steppick comes in to score. RBI swing from Dane Richards. Dane is 2-for-2 today. In this game alone, he had two hits in game one. He found the perfect spot. It was not hit all that hard. It just snuck in between that 5-6 hole by Vance and Thorning. Ryan McKay tried to bunt last time, popped out to the pitcher. He's got a runner at third and first and takes a ball low on the corner. 1-0 to Ryan. What a swing from Dane Richards to salvage what looked like another inning where Schoolcraft was going to get out of a bases-loaded jam with nobody out. We've already seen them do it today. Strike on the inside half. 1-1 to McKay. He's got Pawlenski at third and Richards at first. And they got him picked off. They got Richards picked at second. He's in a rundown. No, he's not. The ball hit off of the head. Wow, Richards gets hit with the throw and coming in to score is Pawlenski. When you're doing a pickle, you have to clear the throwing lane. Right there, Tuttle threw right into the runner, Dane Richards. Also, if you've never seen it before, go on YouTube and look up Cole Calhoun hits himself in the head with the throw. It's incredible. Look, just like what Dane Richards did just right there. He was running to second, and the throw hits him in the head, right in the helmet, allowing the run to score. It's now 4-2 Macomb. Did not have that on my bingo sheet today for one of the runs being scored for Macomb. McKay awaits on a 1-2. Balls and two strikes. Pawlenski scores on yet another errant throw. That's how this inning started. Grzuk reached on an error. Nick Meyer checks the runner at second once, twice. Now kicks and fires. Strike three. Outside corner gets McKay looking. Two more runs in the inning. Dane Richards with an RBI single and a throw that hits Richards as he was trying to steal a bag. Leads to Pawlenski scoring. 4-2, we go to the fourth. This is your home for Macomb Community College Baseball. Welcome back in the top of the fourth inning. Macomb Monarchs with a two-run lead. To get you to this point, Macomb scored two in the first. They allowed two in the second inning to even it up at 2-2. And just recently in the bottom of the third, Macomb grabs two more and take a 4-2 lead here in the fifth with Derek Neufeld back on the mound. First pitch is a ball low and outside. Trouble with it behind the plate was Babcock. A little bit of movement in the Macomb bullpen. Can't say the same for school. Yes, I can. There's a little bit of throwing for Schoolcraft. And we're going to have time called as Babcock is going to need to be seen by the trainer. He looked a little, I guess, ginger after that first catch or receive. And now our trainer Kyle Straka is going to take a look at Babcock's hand. We're going to step aside for just a moment. 4-2 game. We're in the top of the fourth inning. Luke Babcock being tended to right now.
Now catching for Macomb, number 7, Vincent Cowdery.
Back here on the Macomb Monarchs YouTube channel for this doubleheader between the Monarchs and the Schoolcraft Ocelots here on the campus of Macomb Community College. We had to stop in the middle of this inning after just the first pitch. Luke Babcock is headed back to the dugout. Seemed to be having some trouble with his catching hand, either the thumb or index finger, somewhere within there. He has been taken out of the game. Vincent Cowdery is your new catcher for the Monarchs. He will likely hit in that same spot for Luke Babcock. That's the five spot in the lineup. So back to business with Drew Thorning at the plate. There's a 1-0 count to him. Derek Neufeld, a great inning in the third. Retired the side in order. Neufeld's 1-0, high and outside. It's always interesting, too, when you have to switch up catchers, somebody that you warmed up with in pregame. You've gone through the first three innings of the game with them as well, so some adjustment that needs to be done in the next couple of pitches or innings between these two. Three balls, no strikes to Thorning right now. 4-2 is your score. Macomb on top. That pitch completely on the other side of the zone there. Tried to pull the fastball. So a leadoff walk to Thorning. Head coach Taylor Jelikowski out to the mound, and that's going to be the end of the day for Derek Neufeld. Four strikeouts, allowing three hits and two runs. Derek Neufeld's day is done, and we're going to have a new arm on the bump. So as Neufeld exits, Brandon Rice will enter. We'll step aside briefly. New man on the mound for Macomb in a 4-2 ball game. Leadoff walk to
now
Drew Thorning
Macomb,
as a man aboard
number 9
for the Ocelots.
Rice.
find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, hurry boy, it's waiting there for you.
Now batting, the center fielder is Sander Vega.
The new man on the mound, number 9, Brandon Rice, transfer from Madonna University, comes from Eisenhower, and is playing college ball in his backyard right now. He's from Macomb, Michigan. It's the 7th appearance for Rice this season. He's dealing with a man on and nobody out. That concludes the day on the mound for Derek Neufeld. Rice kicks and fires. Here's a ground ball. Fair down the third baseline. Past diving Ryan McKay. It's into the corner. Holding up at third will be Thorning. And just like that, Isander Vega has himself a double, and it's second and third, nobody out.
The shortstop, Dalton Vance.
Neufeld ended his day, 3 innings pitched, 4 walks, 4 strikeouts, and 3 hits allowed with 2 runs earned. Rice trying to work out of a jam now. Inherited the one base runner. Just give up a double to Vega. It's Dalton Vance's turn, who has an RBI single. Schoolcraft looking to tie this game up once again. Little shot swing towards the first base side. Last time out. Rice threw on April 9th. He went one inning, struck out all three, walked one against Indiana Tech's JV squad in a win. Oh, one. Strike two, upper outer corner. Rice was a part of that Madonna University WAC championship team. Had a pretty good amount of innings, I guess, with the program. He threw it, made 18 appearances. Held a 4.96 ERA, 3 saves. He was definitely the man to call upon late in the game, and we're not quite there yet, but it is a point in a much needed victory game that you need. As he gets a swing and a miss. Strikeout from Dalton Vance. One out. That's a big out with runners on second and third.
Number 20, Abel Gutierrez.
I'll bring up Abel Gutierrez, who grounded back to the pitcher's mound last time. That was with the bases loaded. A couple of nice plays from Macomb have kept Schoolcraft at just 2 so far. Ty Stepik threw a runner out at home. Back in the second, here's a foul ball out of play from Gutierrez. That's exactly why head coach Taylor Jelikowski brings in Rice right there. Tough jam, I know he gives up the double, but comes right back with it. Short memory on the mound for the right-hander as he gets a strikeout. Oh, one to the last batter in this lineup for Schoolcraft. Watch out, high and inside fastball. Gutierrez turns out of the way. 1-1. Top of the fourth inning, it's a 4-2 lead for Macomb here at home in game 2. They're trying to sweep a doubleheader against Schoolcraft. We're not able to complete the sweep yesterday. Lost game 1, 4-3, and then dominated in game 2, 15-5. And earlier today, they were able to sneak out a 3-2 walk-off win. Bases loaded, hit by pitch to Derek Ruiz to send it. 2-1. Make it 3-1. That's high and in. Sawyer Pace waits on deck. Very dangerous hitter in the leadoff spot. He's got an RBI single already today. Runners on second and third, one out. First base is open. Here's the 3-1. Breaking ball. Strike two. Gutierrez doesn't drop the bat, and he's got to come back with it now. Thought he had himself a free pass on to first. Instead, it's 3-2. Full count, one out. Runners on second and third. Rice delivers. Checking his swing. He went around. Cowdery's got to throw to first. They complete the out. Drop third strike for out number two. How about Brandon Rice? And what a pitch call. Breaking ball low in the dirt. Gutierrez chases, and he went around. Back-to-back strikeouts for Brandon Rice with runners on second and third and nobody out. Sawyer Pace is at the dish. He's 1-for-2 with an RBI. Rice now facing his very first lefty. Foul back. 0-1. Pace was all geared up and ready to go after that one. Very good swing for Sawyer. Compact, short. RBI single in game one. He did the same back in the second inning of this game. Here's the 0-1. On the lower outside corner for strike two. Pace is in a hole now, 0-2. Cannot give him anything too easy right now. Sawyer Pace, a very good hitter. Wags that bat away from the body. Twirls it over the head. Rice, ready with the 0-2. Ground ball to shortstop. Charging in is Ruiz. It's off his glove. Two runs will score on the error. Sawyer Pace puts it in play, and that ties the ball game. Thorning and Vega both score after the ball crept up on the heel of Ruiz's glove. It got past him, and it's 4-4.
The right fielder, Ben Cannon.
Pace has driven in three runs now. That one via the error from Ruiz. It's now Ben Cannon's turn. Tied up once again. Again, that's been the entire theme of both games today. It was 1-0 Schoolcraft, then 1-1, then 2-1 Schoolcraft, then 2-2. Here in this game, 2-0 Macomb, 2-2 was your score. 4-2 Macomb, and now 4-4. Back and forth, what a battle. First pitch is a ball to Cannon. Rice trying to get out of the jam with a man on. Already two runs have scored in the inning. Rice steps off and checks the runner back. Foul ball to the screen, 1-1. Cannon's 0-for-2 today, a strikeout and a fly out to left. Derek Neufeld started this inning, walked the first batter, and that led to Rice entering. He gave up a double, struck out two, and a costly error at shortstop from Ruiz allows both runners on second and third to score. Here's the 1-1, low in the dirt. Rice checks the runner twice, three times. Now kicks and fires. Swing and a miss. 2-2. Cannon tried to unload with that one. He's going to get another crack with deuces wild. Two pitch on the ground to first. Krizuk makes the play, touches the bag, and that ends the fourth inning, top of the fourth inning. Schoolcraft ties it up for the second time today. It is now 4-4. Sawyer Pace gets both runs to come in with two outs. We go to the bottom of the fourth inning, tied up at four between Macomb and Schoolcraft. You're watching Macomb Community College Baseball.
off for Macomb, number two, Derek Ruiz.
So we're back to a tie ball game in the bottom of the fourth inning. Derek Ruiz will lead things off. He struck out looking his first time. Riley Nigmeyer back on the mound for his fourth inning of work, delivers a fastball high and outside. Playing 2 7-inning contests today from Macomb Baseball Field. Ruiz trying to get something started. He ropes one fouled on the first baseline to even the count up. It'll be Ruiz, Ames, and then back to the top and Alex Mendez. Both teams trading errors in that last inning. A strike on the outside corner. Same spot that Ruiz looked at for strike three in his first at-bat. Might not be the most hittable pitch, but now with two strikes, you gotta go after it. Here's the 1-2. Ground ball, base hit into left field on a couple hops. Derek Ruiz goes opposite field for his first hit in game two.
Number six.
Good start for the Macomb Monarchs. It's a lefty-lefty matchup won by the hitter. And now more movement down in the Ocelot bullpen. Nigmeyer so far has thrown 67 pitches. Three innings of work, four runs, two of them are earned. Ames gonna try to bunt. That was a heavy breaking ball right there for strike one. Seven hits allowed so far for Riley. One walk and three strikeouts. He's also hit one batter. 0-1 curveball down and outside. Ames singled back in the second inning. Another bunt attempt. Another foul ball, line drive back towards the Schoolcraft dugout. 1-2. Wind now starting to blow out towards left center, more left field at the moment. That's going to change quickly as it has really all day. It's been a consistent billowing wind directly in from right field. Here's Nigmeyer's 1-2. Another curveball, not close. Make it 2-2 with nobody out and a man on. Mendez waits on deck. He's 0-2. Two-two pitch is lined into center field for a single. Riley Ames is 2-for-2 today. He shoots it right back up the box. Ruiz going to hold there at second base. Yeah. It's now 2-on with nobody out for the leadoff man, Alex Mendez.
Now batting the second baseman, why you focus, girl? Alex Mendez. I'm a player, quarterback, no NFL.
So things getting interesting once again. Had a feeling there might be more runs scored in this game, too. Both teams stranded several runners on base, did not have those timely hits, and a lot of great pitching and defense as well led to a 3-2 finish in favor of Macomb in walk-off fashion. Ball one inside to Mendez. Pulling back the bunt again, it's low, 2-0. Just one walk so far for Nigmeyer on the mound. He's been very good keeping it close. Off-speed stuff is the only thing that's really getting away from him. He will pull a fastball into a right-handed hitter from time to time, but he's really leaving those off-speed pitches outside to the righties. The 2-0. Inside again, dancing out of the way is Mendez. Three balls and no strikes with two on and nobody out. This could be back-to-back innings where Schoolcraft inherits bases loaded, nobody out. Mendez likely taking all the way here on 3-0. Almost hits him again. That's four straight. Couple base hits, and now a walk to Mendez have loaded him up. Head coach Rob Fays out to the mound to meet with his lefty, Riley Nigmeyer. That is likely going to be the end of the day. We will see as soon as Faye gets to the mound. So Ruiz singled to start the inning. He's at third. Up the middle with a single was Ames. He's down at second base. And a four-pitch walk to Alex Mendez has now loaded the bases with nobody out for back-to-back innings. Back in the third, it was the same deal. Bases loaded, nobody out. And then a double play. 1-2-3 double play back to the pitcher's mound. Left Dane Richards. He was able to grab a two-out clutch hit. And a throwing error led to the fourth run. So Nigmeyer is going to stay in the ballgame. Head coach Rob Fays got trust in his starter, and he just took his hat off to make sure that the reliever down there is ready to go. One thing you'll see from head coaches is they'll take their hat off and wave it down to the bullpen, and if he gets that same hat wagging response, he knows that the reliever in the bullpen is ready to go in the game. Most dangerous hitter, Brady Krazuk at the plate. Bases loaded, nobody out, and a first pitch breaking ball in the inside corner. Boy, that's a good pitch. Starts in on the shoulder of Krazuk and sets in for a strike. 4-4 game, we're in the fourth. This ball's gonna scoot away from Westfall all the way to the backstop. Coming in to score is Ruiz. Second and third now, and it's 5-4 Macomb. Hard to judge pass ball or wild pitch there as it got away from Westfall, but I think the throw was so far wide of the right-handed box that you gotta call a wild pitch there. You have to. It's 1-1 at the moment to Brady Krazuk with runners on second and third. Schoolcraft has brought their infield in, and this is gonna get past the glove of Westfall again. Back-to-back pitches lead to back-to-back runs. 6-4 game now as Ames comes in. Now that one is a pass ball. That one snipped off of the webbing of Westfall's glove. He just didn't catch that one. So now a runner on third base. Macomb hasn't had to do anything to score these runs. Krazuk has watched two people cross the plate as he has been at the plate. 2-1 to Brady. 0-for-1, reached on an error, walked and scored in first. Watch out, another breaking ball high and inside, and that's gonna walk him. Oh no, it won't. I think Brady thought it hit him. And our field umpire, Tim Heigl's gonna come in here and interject. I think he's gonna have some differing opinions to what Blake Barnes behind the dish has. Barnes with a not the best angle to see that, and neither do we. Heigl, who's out in the field, has a much better eye, and it is gonna hit him. So Krazuk, that's his fourth hit by pitch of the year. He's down to first base, and now there's going to be another conversation had between our home plate umpire and Rob Fay. Four straight base runners here for Macomb in the inning. 6-4 is your score. That's the second time today there's been a discussion about if the ball hit a left-handed batter. If you remember back to game one, it was Derek Ruiz who was hit with the bases loaded in the bottom of the seventh inning in a tie ball game. And that won the ball game for Macomb. It just clipped the jersey of Derek Ruiz, and this is gonna be the end of the day for Riley Nigmeyer on the mound. After that hit batter to Krazuk, head coach Rob Fay's got to pull the trigger and go to the bullpen. We'll step aside. Macomb leads at 6-4 after a couple of errant throws and a passed ball from the Schoolcraft catcher. Be back in a minute here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Nobody out, runners on first and third. Macomb with a 6-4 lead. We'll be right back.
your attention, please. Now pitching for Schoolcraft, number 8, Johnny Sowards.
Back here in the bottom of the 4th inning, and a 2-run lead for your Macomb Monarchs. Johnny Sowards, the true two-way man, is on the mound right now, making his 8th appearance of the year, 19 and 2-thirds innings pitched so far. He's allowed 15 runs, walked 4 and struck out 26. And now he's going to hit Ty Stepik on the first pitch. Off speed gets away from Sowards, and the bases are reloaded with nobody out still. To break down those last couple of batters here for Macomb, Riley Nigmeyer gave up back-to-back base hits to Ruiz and Ames. After that, Mendez was walked to load the bases. The next two pitches were all the way to the backstop past Dom Westfall, the catcher, leading to those two runs. Now a hit batter to Krizuk, and then to Stepik. Pawenski, deep to right field. Going back is Cannon. He makes the catch. Tagging up at third is going to be Mendez, and he scores. Down to third is going to go Krizuk as well on the sacrifice. That means Ty Stepik gets second base. Another wild throw at third base as they try to get Krizuk, and that lets another man advance. 7-4 is your score on the sacrifice fly from Dylan Pawenski.
Number 7, Vincent Cowdery.
So now it's Vincent Cowdery's turn as he's hitting in place of Luke Babcock, who came out due to injury last inning. Krizuk's down at third base. Mendez just scored on the sacrifice fly. Stepik, he picked up an extra base on the wild throw. Second and third, one out. Cowdery getting his first at-bat of the afternoon, takes a ball way outside. Little slide piece there from Sowards on the mound. Inherited runners on the corners, hit the first batter he saw and got a fly out from Pawenski. Fastball high and inside. Cowdery waiting on a 2-0 pitch. Finds the outside corner for a strike. Nice pitch from Johnny. 7-4 lead for your Monarchs with 2 in scoring position and 1 out. Schoolcraft trying to stop the bleeding here as they have their entire infield in on the grass. The 2-1. It's going to get away from Westfall again, in and out of his glove. Krizuk does not pull the trigger and go home. That could have been another run right there. Brady must have just not had a good jump. And that's okay. I mean, you have less than 2 outs. You don't absolutely need the run. You're not losing right now. So smart decision from Krizuk over at third base. You only go on that if you know you can get there. And if there's any doubt in your mind, you have to hold up. So good job over there. And Stepik as well, not running him off the base at third. Cowdery fights to 3-2 now as he chops that one back to the screen. Johnny Sowards just came in the ball game for Riley Nigmeyer. Here's a tap foul from Cowdery, stays 3-2. Vincent trying to put something hard on the ground past the infield or deep enough in the outfield to score Krizuk. It's second and third with one out Stepik. He was hit by a pitch, same with Brady. 3 runs in the inning. Here's a line drive to right center field. Cannon coming in. He makes the catch. Krizuk's going to tag. And he's going to score. Staying at second base is Ty Stepik. And it's back-to-back sack flies. Vincent Cowdery gets the job done with a line shot to right center field.
The left fielder, Dane Richards.
Well done from the Monarchs. They lead it now 8-4. Back-to-back sack flies out to right field, Pawenski, and now Cowdery. Dane Richards, 2-for-2 with an RBI today. He's up for the third time in as many innings. He'll take a slider outside. Base hit in the second, he was stranded at third base. Base hit in the third to drive in a run, and now he hits here in the fourth. Monarchs lead by 4, it's been a big inning. Pitch off the plate outside. Nice take from number 61, Dane Richards. Sowards checks the runner at two, and this ball is going to hit Richards on the Evo shield. Does he stay in the box? They call a foul ball. Home plate umpire Blake Barnes says that ball hit the bat. So staying in the box now is Richards. Maybe he's seen too many hit by pitches so far today to let him have it. Head coach Taylor Jelikowski out onto the field to have a very short conversation. So after a small pause, Dane Richards back up at the plate at 2-1. Let's see if ball don't lie. Foul back. It's 2-2 now. Always tough pitches to officiate there if you're the home plate umpire. If it gets a piece of the forearm, the hand, the bat. The hand is an extension of the bat, even though you will be rewarded with a hit by pitch if it catches the right piece. Ground ball to third. It's a nice play from Thorning. He gathers and throws to first, and that's out number three. Four runs in the inning for Macomb. We go to the fifth inning with some conversation on the field between our home plate umpire and Taylor Jelikowski of Macomb. Big swings coming from Pawensky and Vincent Cowdery. A couple sack flies and a couple wild pitches make it 8-4. We've played four innings here in Macomb. Be back in a minute. This is your home for Macomb Community College Baseball. Back here in the fifth inning, Brandon Rice is back onto the mound, facing the 3-4-5 batters, starting with Dom Westfall. Tough inning behind the plate last frame, allowing two runs to score. Could have been three. Krizuk held up at third, but he was driven in regardless on a sacrifice fly. 8-4 is your score. Macomb has a hold on the game, but if you think Schoolcraft is going to go away quietly, might be mistaken there. They have tied the game up multiple times here today in game one, and Macomb did the same in the first one. Rice, swing and a miss. A little half swing sword there from Westfall. He's down 1-2. Westfall, Tuttle, and Elsie. Elsie's been the best hitter all day long in both games for Schoolcraft. Swing and a miss. Fastball at the letters. Westfall couldn't catch up. One gone in the fifth.
First baseman Brian Tuttle.
0 for 2 day for Tuttle. He's got a couple of strikeouts. Rice working that right side of the rubber. He's looked very good since giving up that double to Isander Vega back last inning. He's already recorded three strikeouts in his last five batters faced. 0-1 to Tuttle. That fastball low, and you can see a little extra pep in the step of number 9 on the mound right now. He's amped up, and he is dialed in. Throwing with a couple extra MPHs on that fastball. Here's an off-speed, fouled back to the screen. And those are the best pitches. When you see a guy amped on the mound and you think he's going to give you gas, and he goes with the off-speed, completely throws off the hitter. Rice, big deep breath as he goes over the head. Here's the 1-2. Strike 3, outside corner, and Tuttle's gone down looking for the third time today. Back-to-back strikeouts, that's 4 total for Rice so far. Four Ks in 6 batters faced, he's dialed. Owen Elsie, as we said, best bat in this lineup today. He's 0-for-1 with a walk and a run scored in this game, had a couple of hits in the first one. He's that pesky hitter in the 5 spot that you just have a hard time getting out, and he pulls one into right field for a single. Just does what's necessary to find a way aboard, and he takes the first pitch out to Ty Stepik. It's a 2-out single for the Ocelots. 1-for-1 with a walk and a run scored today for Drew Thorning. Runs in the 2nd and the 4th for Schoolcraft, 2 in each inning have led to their 4. Macomb scored 2 in the 1st, 2 in the 3rd, and then 4 last inning for their total of 8. Thorning waiting on that first pitch, ground ball to shortstop. Ruiz has trouble, nope, he cleanly fields and throws to 2nd. Looked like he might have double clutched for a moment, but that ends the inning. Brandon Rice, couple of strikeouts, he's got 4 total today. We go to the bottom of the 5th inning, 8-4 lead for Macomb over Schoolcraft in game 2 of our doubleheader. You're watching Macomb Baseball.
Wanted the fame, but not the cover of Newsweek. Oh well, guess beggars can't be choosy. Wanted to receive attention from my music. Wanted to be left alone in public, excuse me. But wanting my cake and eat it too. And wouldn't it both ways? Fame made me a balloon. Cause my ego inflated when I'm loosey. But it was confusing. Cause all I wanted to do was be the Bruce Lee. A Bruce Lee, abused me. Used it as a tool when I boosted. Hit the lottery, ooh wee. But with what I gave up to get, it was bittersweet. It was like winning a used me. I'm finally, cause I think I'm getting so huge, I need a shrink. I'm beginning to lose sleep. One shit, two sheep, going cuckoo, and cookie is cool key. But I'm actually weirder than you think. Cause
I'm friends with the monster.
Bottom of the 5th inning here from Warren, Michigan on the campus of Macomb Community College. It's game 2, inning number 5. Ryan McKay, Derek Ruiz, and Riley Ames to face Johnny Sowards with a 4-run lead. Breaking ball, strike 1 at the belt to McKay. He's been quiet here in game 2, a strikeout and a pop out to the mound. Game 1, he was awesome. A couple of plays in the field, double, single, RBI. Takes a fastball at the eyes, 1-1. Schoolcraft definitely had momentum coming into the 2nd game, just thinking about who they had on the mound with Riley Nygmeyer, and he gave a few solid innings. Here's a sky-high fly ball to shallow left field, and making the catch is going to be Dalton Vance in shallow left. But with the crafty lefty in Schoolcraft, kind of having some more motivation to come out here in these first couple of innings. They gave up 2 early, but battled back. And when you see a team battle back and answer right away, it starts to kind of shift things a little bit. But the Monarchs did a great job in that last half inning of putting up 4 and widening into a good chunk of a lead. Line drive out to left field, diving, nope, making the catch is Elsie. He looked like he was about to dive and stayed on his feet. Good swing from Ruiz. There's two gone.
The center fielder, Riley Ames.
So two quick outs for Johnny Sowards on the mound facing Riley Ames, who's 2-for-2. A couple of singles for Riley. He also scored back in the fourth. Lines the first pitch back. Like that swing from Derek Ruiz as well, last AB. He's now 1-for-3 with a run scored. Ruiz, last two swings, opposite field, hard hit balls on the barrel. Love watching him go opposite field as well, using the entirety of the baseball diamond. That off speed misses down and away. Westfall's gotta kinda stick that on the corner there and hold it so we can get that frame job for a strike. It's 1-1 instead. Sowards, the second pitcher today for Schoolcraft. They didn't dip into their bullpen until the seventh inning of game one, and that's where things went wrong for the Ocelots. Two balls and one strike to Riley. Same spot, slider misses down and away. Three and one with two outs. 8-4 lead for the Monarchs here at home in the bottom of the fifth inning. Fastball high for ball four. With two outs, let's see if Riley Ames maybe takes off for second base. I'd love to see him try to swipe a bag here in this game. We know he's got speed, seen him track down a ball all the way out in deep left center field on a line. Talked about yesterday, it was a split series between Macomb and Schoolcraft. Here's a fly ball to center field from Alex Mendez. Long run for Vega, he's still going back, makes the catch. A couple feet away from the 440 sign out in dead center field. The second time that Mendez has tanked a ball out to center field, and it's tracked down from the Ocelots. Macomb gets a base runner, but no more. We go to the sixth, 8-4 lead for the Monarchs. This is your home for Macomb baseball.
Now batting, the center fielder is Sander Vega.
Here in the sixth, Brandon Rice will face Sander Vega, Dalton Vance, and Abel Gutierrez. Breaking ball for a strike at the letters. Rice, he's been cooking right now. Struck out the first two in the fifth. Also, the first two outs in the fourth. He's got four total in his last seven batters faced, and right now, he's up 0-2 on Vega. 1-for-1 with a double and a walk today for Isander. He just made a really nice catch out in center field to rob Mendez of an extra base hit. And Alex Mendez, too, he's been having some incredible swings his last few at-bats. A couple of bombs out to straightaway center and left center field. It's just a far ballpark, and a swing and a miss. That's five strikeouts for Brandon Rice. My goodness. Sits down Vega with ease right there.
Now batting number 13, Dalton Vance.
And this was the right move to go to. I mean, Derek Neufeld was dominating hitters, but he also was allowing some walks, and there were some hits mixed in there that allowed this Schoolcraft team to creep back into the into a tie ball game. Here's a fly ball out to deep right. Stepik going back, now coming in. Makes the catch with two hands. Quickly two gone here in the sixth inning. With that win earlier today, Macomb moved into second place in the MCCAA
20,
East at 7-4, gaining a game on Henry Ford College. They're now 13-12 overall as well, getting over that 500 hump. Rice over the head, first pitch, ground ball fouled on the first baseline. Abel Gutierrez, he's 0-2 today, a strikeout and a fielder's choice. And Rice just so good at getting ahead of hitters, whether it's a swinging first pitch strike or he finds the corner to right-handed hitters, challenging lefties also on the inner half. Loves that left side of the box right there, as that pitch just misses a bit low. One and one. Big deep breath on the mound for Rice. He goes over the head again. Fastball off the plate. And I got to cover a little bit of Brandon Rice last year calling games for Madonna, and he has picked up the velocity for sure. Got the same sort of motion he's going through right now, but my goodness, he's got some extra velo. And you can tell. I mean, with five strikeouts, two. He's got a 3-1 count on Gutierrez here, though, with two outs. Want to try to battle back, see if he can get a swing and a rollover ground ball to Ruiz. The 3-1 fastball is down and away, just missing the spot. Two-out walk for B. Rice has a man aboard, and it's now Sawyer Pace.
Now batting number one, Sawyer Pace.
Wind has now transitioned. It's blowing straight out towards the left field foul pole, so from right to left across your screen. There's a first pitch strike to Pace on the lower outer corner. Good day for Sawyer in this game. He's 1-for-3 with two RBIs. Check that, three RBIs. Hit that chopper to Ruiz that allowed two runs to score back in the fourth. Here's a ground ball to Ruiz, backhand play. Throw to second, bang, bang, they did get him. Mendez gets to the bag in time. Nice play by Derek Ruiz on the backhand. We go to the bottom of the sixth inning. 8-4 lead for Macomb. They get out of another inning with man on base. This is your home for Macomb Community College Baseball.
Leading off for Macomb, the first baseman, Brady Krazuk.
Big number 44 steps in the box for the fourth time today. Brady Krazuk to face Johnny Sowards. Cut and a miss just over top of that baseball. Little slider dove down and in on the feet. It's an 8-4 lead. We're in the bottom of the sixth inning. More movement in the bullpen, but by how Brandon Rice has been cooking these last couple frames, we'd love to see him go out and try to finish the job. 0-2 quickly to Krazuk. It's going to be Stepik and Pawensky right after. Pawensky also with three of the eight RBIs today. Strike three on the lower outer corner. Krazuk goes down looking on three pitches. Didn't like that call. It was right there on the corner, opposite
right fielder,
part of the plate.
Ty Stepik.
It's now Ty Stepik's turn. And he has been hit twice today. He's one for one with a couple of hit by pitches. Slider down and away, missing. Big opportunity these next couple of outs on both sides for Macomb. Want to try to get some insurance and widen this lead, then finish things in the top of the seventh. That's a fastball high and in, 2-0 to tie. Stepik threw a runner out at home in the second inning. Heck of a throw from right field on a single. Here he is popping one up to shortstop. A couple of steps back for Dalton Vance. He makes that grab. Two away. Dylan Pawenski now will step in. We already talked about his three RBIs. Two-run base hit in the first. Single and scored in the third, and then a sac fly in the fourth. So every time he's at the dish, producing for the Monarchs. Sowards going to deliver a first pitch that is crushed to right center field. Coming in is Cannon, and not able to make the catch. Ranging back was Sawyer Pace. That's going to be a base hit. That ball landed much shorter than I thought. It looked like a great swing from Pawenski. He just got it off the end of the bat, and that's why it didn't go anywhere.
Now batting, number seven.
The original trajectory seemed like it was going to get in the gap. My depth perception might also not be that great as we're into inning number 13 today. But it should get better as the game goes on, right? I don't get it. Nonetheless, Pawenski's got a two-out base hit. Vincent Cowdery back up. He had a sacrifice fly, his first and only at-bat today. He entered the game for Luke Badcock, who we are hoping is just fine as he was dealing with some sort of glove side hand injury. There's a breaking ball in the outside corner, 1-1. Johnny Sowards on the mound. We talked about him being a two-way guy. You see it more and more at the collegiate level. Breaking ball pulled foul on the third baseline. Sowards seems like a pretty solid hitter too, but usually you see it where a guy enters into a program as an infielder hitter. He's got a great arm, and the coaching staff at one point or another, after seeing the offensive stats not be there, you go, hey, why don't you switch to be a pitcher? And that's how sometimes it happens, where guys will slowly transition from being an infielder and a hitter to a pitcher. But Sowards also a very good batting average as well, so he can do both. There's a fastball just off the plate, but you'll see that more times than not. NIIA JC ball and Division III as well. A lot of two-way guys and a lot of guys making transitions from the infield onto the mound. Two balls, two strikes, two outs. Cowdery leaves that alone. Another slider diving low and outside. Monarchs trying to put together a two-out rally, up by four, looking for some insurance here in the bottom of the sixth. Pawenski's back in safely as he might have been getting antsy over there at first. He looked just fine. Sowards was making sure. Eight runs, nine hits, and one error for Macomb today. The 3-2. Cowdery lines it out to left center field. It's going to drop for a single. Pawenski's on his horse. Headed to third base. The slide, the tag. He's out. Pawenski thought he got under the tag. What a play. Out there from Owen Elsie, cutting down the man at third. We go to the seventh inning. 8-4 is your score. Macomb on top, trying to sweep a doubleheader here at home. You're watching Macomb Community College Baseball. We'll be right back for the seventh.
The right fielder, Ben Cannon.
Top of the seventh inning, Brandon Rice is back on the mound. There's a strike. A 1-0 count to start the inning after Macomb, I think they went over the time limit to get ready for an inning, and that led to a 1-0 count. And it's quickly 1-2 to Ben Cannon. Brandon Rice has been sensational since entering the game. 5 strikeouts, just 1 hit. Gave up a double to Vega back in the fourth inning. That's been it. Check that, he's given up another base hit, and that's strike 3. Make it 6 for Brandon Rice. Cannon checked his, he did not check his swing, I should say. There's one away.
The catcher, Dom Westfall.
0 for 2 with the walk for Dom Westfall. Rice, over the head through his windup. Delivers a first pitch down and out. Rice has already sat down Westfall once today. That was back in the fifth inning. Westfall ahead 2-0 right now. 4-run lead for Macomb, trying to sweep the doubleheader. They need 2 more outs. There's a strike on the outside corner to make it 2-1. It's been a wider zone east to west for our home plate umpire today, Blake Barnes, rather than Tim Heigl in the first one. But as we said early, you got to be able to adjust. There's strike 2 with the letters. You have to be able to give what the umpires are, or take what the umpires are giving you and try to make it work in your favor. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 1 out. That fastball for strike 3 at the letters. Westfall goes down looking. There's 2 gone. And Brian Tuttle is the last chance for the Ocelots here on the road in game 2. Eight runs on 10 hits for Macomb, rivaling the 4 runs on 5 hits for Schoolcraft. Rice has been a difference maker in these last several innings, completely shutting down this Schoolcraft lineup. They had 4 runs in the first 4 innings. They've had 2 hits since that point. There's a breaking ball snapped in for a strike, leveling the count at 1-1. Tuttle today, he's 0 for 3, struck out looking all 3 times. Rice, the 1-1, foul out of play. Now Schoolcraft down to their final strike. A very complete game on the Macomb side so far. Scoring in 3 out of the 6 innings, they come to the plate. And all crooked numbers at that. 2 runs in this first, 2 in the third, and 4 in the fourth. Rice, over the head on the 1-2. Swing and a miss! Rice strikes out the side, and this game is over. Macomb sweeps the doubleheader here at home, and they are now 8-3, tied for first place in the MCCAA East Division. A 3-2 walk-off victory in game 1, and a domination 8-4 victory in game 2. Brandon Rice was your difference maker. My goodness, he had himself. Let's count them up here. 3, 4, make it 6 and 8 strikeouts for Brandon Rice after he came in with nobody out and 2 on in the fourth inning. Macomb, they move to 14-12 on the year overall, 8-4 in conference play. They are now tied with Jackson just underneath them, actually in second place. They're 8-3 are the Jackson Jets, 8-4 are your Macomb Monarchs. On the Schoolcraft side, they fall to 17-21. And 5-8 in conference. That's going to conclude our doubleheader today from Warren, Michigan on the campus of Macomb. I want to thank Brian Rizzo, our stat man working the streams. I want to thank Tim Johnston, SID, here as well, as he was setting up our streams and making sure everything was A-OK today on his end as a viewer. And then as well, Jamari Cusmano, he was handling our scoreboard today. I want to give him a big shout-out as well, as he was here helping out the fellas getting our broadcast together. Your final scores one more time from our doubleheader. 3-2, a walk-off winner. Derek Ruiz was hit by a pitch with the bases loaded in the bottom of the seventh. And the Monarchs win that first one 3-2. 8-4 is your final score of game two. Brandon Rice gets the win. And Macomb moves to 8-4 in conference. A couple RBIs. Dylan Pawensky had three. Vincent Cowdery had himself a sacrifice fly, and Dane Richards as well. This is Tom Cavanaugh saying so long. Thank you once again. We'll be back next week for more Macomb Athletics, Macomb Baseball, later on this week here at home. Have a great night, everybody. Until then, we'll see you later. Take care. Have a great night.